our great host to have with us, Rabbi Yosef.
Thank you, Helen. איך מדליקים את זה? Doesn't work. Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everyone. I would like to start first by thanking Hakel and Agudat Israel of Medicine, of Mordechai Gelber, and of course J Root Radio for broadcasting live and bringing my lectures and many other lectures to almost every house here in Brooklyn, Queens, and some other places worldwide. I brought you some free CDs over there. Anyone who would like later to sponsor CDs for the future can contact me after the lecture. Those CDs are for free. If you know my website, it's called divineinformation.com. There's about more than 2,000 lectures there. And one of them is a very popular lecture. It's a video that I made a few years ago. It's called Torah in Science. That lecture became very popular because it's a four-hour film, as you can see the DVD right there. And it's divided to three parts. First part is Ma'amad Har Sinai, proving that the Jews stood in Mount Sinai, heard the voice of Hashem speaking to Moshe. How do we know for sure it happened? It's an hour and 20 minutes, first session. Second session, it's proving that the oral Torah is divine, not only the written Torah. The oral Torah has divine knowledge in it that leaves no doubt that a person was unable to know it. Definitely not 2,000 years ago, or 3,300 years ago, only the creator of the world was able to know those things. And the third part of the film is the purpose of life, the purpose of the creation, the purpose of the human being, the world that we live in, and most frequent questions that people ask nonstop, Jews and non-Jews. I answer one after the other. So basically, if a person is a complete atheist and he watched this film carefully, I didn't see anyone who was able to challenge it so far in the last 5-6 years, not even one. And I argue with some scientists and doctors and some smart people, and they just don't have answers to those proofs because it leaves no doubt. It's just very clear. Today, since the first lecture is already very famous, I decided to do what we call Torah and Science number 2, different one than the one in the DVD. But it's still recommended for those who did not watch it, frum or not frum, it doesn't matter, to watch this Torah and Science. It will help us to tighten the emuna of our children, of our relatives, friends, colleagues, Jews that have doubts about the Torah. There's many challenges in today's world. So this film is really a necessity. Let's move on. This lecture usually takes 3 hours, but today I'm limited to about an hour and 10 minutes. And I know you already been from the morning here, so I don't want to stretch it too long. I'll just give you a little taste of it. Later, if you want to watch the rest of it, you can go into my website, search for Knowledge in Chazal or Torah and Science number 2. You can watch it online. As we know, when the Torah was given to us, it's a combination of written and oral Torah, and there's no way to understand one word from the written Torah without reviewing the oral Torah carefully. There's no way to understand the literal meaning of the words, even if you think you understand. When you review the actual meaning, you find that it's sometimes the opposite of what you thought. And plus, there's no way to understand any one of the 613 commandments that Hashem gave us without reviewing the oral law. There's no way to understand. No one would know where to put tefillin. No one would know where to circumcise the baby. No one would know what melacha of Shabbos is. None of these things we would know without the oral law. And we see a few times in the Torah that Hashem said to Moshe Rabbeinu, do as I showed you in the mountain. Ka'asher eriticha. And it does not clarify in the written text what exactly he showed him. He showed him information that it's critical for Judaism to become a loyal Jew, but it did not bother to write it in a written Torah. There's not that much time to explain why Hashem separated the written from the oral law. There's many reasons for it. One of the main reasons, briefly, I would say, because the Torah was given to the Jewish nation, it applies to Gentiles as well. But it was mainly given to the Jews as a gift from Hashem. This is all his secrets about the creation, about the purpose of life. Therefore, he wanted only the Jews to have full control of his book. That's why he separated the main part of Judaism, which is instructions how to keep the laws, from the actual names of the commandments, which without the instruction, they are worthless. There are things in a Torah that today we discover with the help of the scientists and NASA and all kinds of other scientific evidence that we discover in these days, how the Torah was able to tell us things 3,000 years before scientists discovered it. Let's give you examples of what I'm talking about. The Torah in Bereshit Aleph, right in the beginning, it says, Vayas Elokim et Arakia. Hashem made the Rakia, the heavens, what we call in English atmosphere. Vayavdel ben amayim asher mitachat la Rakia leben amayim asher me'al la Rakia. And Hashem separated between the water that under the heaven and the water above the heaven. And right away, if you ask any scientist today what water there is above the heaven, he won't know what you're talking about. Where? The space. Where do you have water above the heaven? Right away, if you do not know, it looks like a critical mistake. He separated between the waters, so fine. We see water, 72% of the world today is water. But where is the other water that he's speaking about? The question becomes even bigger when we see, when we review in the book of Tehillim, which is a part of the Tanakh, Perek Kuf Memchet, chapter 148, it says like this, Aleluhu Shmei HaShamayim, the heaven should praise God, Ve'amayim Asher Me'al HaShamayim, and the water above the heaven should also praise God. Which makes it very interesting what kind of water they're talking about. Ya'alelu et Shem Hashem, ki hu tziva v'nivrau. You have to praise Hashem, the water. Why? Based on His word, you were created. When we go into the oral Torah, what we call the Talmud, which is a combination of the oral information, Chazal are telling us 2,000 years ago that the water, the upper water, are standing b'ma'amar. The water are standing based on the word of the creator of the world, and they are solid, keglidei kerach, solid ice. Glida in Hebrew, in modern Hebrew, it's ice cream. It comes from the word in the Talmud, glid, which is glidei, it means ice, pieces of ice. We know that the world have billions and billions of stars, and some of them are 1,000 times bigger than Earth or more. Today, the scientists discovered that many of the stars are covered with big, thick layer of ice. It could be 30, 40 feet of ice covering the entire stars from the top. Some stars, it's basically all ice. It's one huge chunk of ice. Every once in a while, we look up to the sky and we see a line of fire. And today they tell the children, make a wish, there's a star falling. But of course we know it's nonsense, no stars is falling. So every star stays exactly where Kadosh Baruch Hu commanded him to stay, and he moves exactly as Hashem said. So what does it mean when we see lines of fire every once in a while? The answer is, when the stars are in movement, some of the galaxies and some individual stars coming sometimes closer to the sun. The sun has a very, very high temperature, 15 million degrees Celsius, which is more than 20 million Fahrenheit, like in America, degrees. And the temperature in the edge of the sun, just where the shell is 6,000 degrees, which is about 8,000 degrees here or something like that, which is a very high temperature. When a star comes too close to the sun melts a large portion of that stars immediately. It's like putting ice right next to a very high fire. And it melts millions of tons of water immediately, and they fall into space. And with the light of the sun, it looks like a line of fire. This is what happened to those stars that are covered with ice. And today we know that if we review the amount of ice in the upper world, which is above the heaven, we find that there's much more water over there than the little water that we have in our world, which is about 3/4 of the world. We look at this world, 72% is water, we are very amazed. That's not even a drop compared to the water that we have above the atmosphere, above the heaven. The question is, how did Chazal know 2,000 years ago when there was no satellites, there was no way to go anywhere, the maximum you could see that you have 6,000 stars, nobody knew there's more galaxies, and nobody knew what's in those stars, how they knew that there's water over there. Imagine today the scientists would discover that every star that they measure, none of it has ice, and the temperature, it's perfectly fine there. That would be the first mistake in the Torah. Now remember, writing such a thing in a book, and one day someone discover you're wrong, is making the entire Torah questionable. Why? If it's a divine book, if it's divine information who comes, whether it's written or whether it's oral, it doesn't matter. A divine information should never have mistake. Why? It was given by the creator of the world. If God forbid is capable of making mistakes, how we can rely on how can we rely? That's a warning not to talk too much. maybe I crossed the line here. All right. Anyway, the point is that there shouldn't be any mistakes. Why? Because if a person sees there's any mistake, then he begins to have questions about the rest of the mitzvot. How do I know it's not going to be the second mistake? Amar Rabbi Yoshua, Rabbi Yoshua say, Kol haolam, thank you. I'll hold it. Kol haolam, Amar Rabbi Yoshua, Kol haolam, mimayim elyonim ushote. The whole world is drinking from the upper water. In the Pirkei Rabbi Eliezer, chapter 5, which was written about 2,000 years ago, it's actually specified that there's two kinds of rain. One rain that comes from the ocean water who evaporate and they go high and they create the clouds and later there's an explosion and the rain is falling. This is what we are used to. And the second kind of the rain comes from the treasure of the creator of the world, of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And this is what it's mean when it say, Iftach Hashem lecha et otzaro atov, Hashem will open his precious treasure for you from heaven. He will send special blessed rain, and this is the rain who bless the seeds and make all the fruits and vegetables, everything grows. As the pasuk in Devarim Chafchet, Deuteronomy 28, verse 12, this is what it says: Iftach Hashem lecha et otzaro atov et hashamayim. Hashem would open the special treasure. The Pirkei de Rabbi Eliezer say that every once in a while, this water will come not from regular clouds. This is special rain who comes and bless the entire ground, and that's where all the blessing come to the world from. Then, the next thing that I would like to discuss is, we know, according to what we can prove today, that every 3 seconds, a meteor enters Earth. But we have the atmosphere that grinds every piece of rock who falls to our direction. It's a special protection that Hashem made for the world. What are these asteroids? They are pieces from stars who constantly break and fall into space. If a person would look at the world in 1 second, if we had a lens that we can see what happened around us in space, we will be not only amazed, we will be completely shocked. For the argument's sake, I would like to explain what I mean. Try to imagine right now a little ball right here in the air. Nothing is holding it. A basketball right here. And then there are many, many balls in a room. Many. And those balls, some of them are much bigger, some of them more or less the same size, constantly having pieces breaking from them and falling straight down. And this ball, if one of those pieces who are broken would hit the wall, it can destroy the entire wall, because some pieces are thousands of kilometers big and are falling into space. What would happen if one of those large pieces would fall and would break through the atmosphere? The atmosphere can grind up to a certain size. But if a piece size of a whole state would fall towards the earth, the atmosphere would not be able to break it to pieces. It would fall into earth and can kill millions of people in a second. If it falls in a city like Manhattan or Europe, it can be 50 million people can die in less than a second. It would be the end of the world. Financially, physically, it would be a disaster. Much worse than any atomic bomb that people can imagine. The question is how it did not happen when there's so many millions of people constantly are falling, not even one eat the place where we live in? Is it possible? Is something like this can be coincidence? Let me make it a little bit more clear. Try to imagine that there is a line of soldiers who are about to shoot someone supposed to be executed. So they all have a machine gun, like Uzi machine gun, and they stand on line, and they tell him, you have to run left and right, and we have to shoot you. If you make it, you go, you back and forth from the entire room, and we shoot thousands of bullets per minute, and none of the bullets would hit you, you get your life back. What are the odds that thousands of bullets would go every second, and this person would make even one step? The answer, there's no chance. This is basically what's happened to our world. There are thousands of bullets who are shooting, and none of them hit us. If one of them would hit us, we would be broken to millions of pieces. But it gets even better. There are so many billions and trillions of stars. The number of the stars, which I spoke in my first film, Torah and Science, is 1 in 18 digits, which is a 19 digits number. Don't even know how to say it in English. But it's a very, very large number. And it's very, very interesting because from all the stars that we have in space, the only place that our world could have been stated right there, it's the place where it is. So let me explain to you. If our Earth would be a little bit closer to the sun by 1%, we would get burned in a second. If it would be further away by 1 or 2%, we would freeze in a minute. So the only place where our world could be is exactly where it is. Now, if you look at the Milky Way when there are 9 stars, the Milky Way, we see that the Earth should have been in a different place because it looks like a banana shape. It's like a hand picked up our world and moved it to the right. If it would be where it was supposed to be, we would get burned in less than a second. There would not be life here. The only place where the Earth should have been is where it is. Is something like this going to be coincidence? Of course not. What is it like? Imagine if I take you now to the ocean, which is very, very wide, and I throw 1/4 to the bottom of the ocean, and I say, I'm very generous today. I'm willing to give you $1 billion if you pass one test. And you're all anxious to know, and you say, what is the test? And I say, you have to take another 1/4 now. We are in a boat. You have to throw it to the bottom of the ocean, and your 1/4 has to fall exactly on mine. Once it will reach 10 miles depth, it will go all the way to the bottom of the ocean. It will fall exactly on mine. You get $1 billion. Any one of you would even throw his 1/4? Probably not. This guy is a wise guy. He's very generous with something he will never have to pay. Why? There's no chance. What's the chance I will fall exactly where it is? This is more or less the chance that the Earth will be where it is by coincidence, without a planner, without a creator. Why? From unlimited amounts, trillions and trillions of options, there's only one correct option. And that's exactly where it is, where the Earth is. Something like this can never happen by a random explosion or whatever some scientists try and claim. It's really very, very foolish because it doesn't make any sense whatsoever. So let's see what I'm talking about. In June 38, 1908, there was a huge explosion in Tunguska in the center of Siberia. A huge meteor, size of 30,000 ton. A ton is 2,200 pounds. It's like the size of a refrigerator. So that's the size of this piece of ice that hit Siberia was 30,000 refrigerators, just for us to understand, combined. Imagine the size of the Empire State Building, maybe, or something like that, right? So it fell in the middle of Siberia. Because of that, it released energy that is equal to an atomic bomb, 12 megaton, which is 12 million ton of explosive. Witnesses saw that the huge meteor was seen in sky few seconds before it hit Earth. People who stood 60 kilometers away, which is 100 miles away, 96 to be precise, they fell on the floor. So try to imagine what we're saying here. Go to the end of Long Island now. It's the Hamptons over there. From here to there, it's very, very far. If it hit right here in Brooklyn, people over there in the end of Long Island fell on the floor. That's how it shook the earth. Not only that, all over the world they checked seismological tests and they said that if this meteor would hit any other city in the world, tens of millions of people would die. Later, the scientists found out that this piece broke, this meteor broke from the star called Enka. It fell exactly in the only place it was safe to fall, in the middle of nowhere, Siberia, when it's all ice anyway. Just imagine any other place it would fall, even if it would fall in the ocean, it would create such a tsunami that would wash out cities nearby. Because pieces like this fall into the water, I don't have to tell you what it creates. There was only one place in the world that could have fallen. Two places. One in Siberia and one in the middle of the desert when there's nothing nearby. There's only two places. And it fell in one of the two places. However, there was Professor Fred Weifel from Howard University proved that the stars are a combination of ice and dust and other material. A small star has billions of tons of ice, and a big star has thousands of billions of ice. Today we know without a doubt that the water in our Earth is a drop compared to the water that we have in other stars. In recent years, scientists discovered an amazing phenomenon. What did they discover? That the stars that we see are falling, as I say, when they enter the atmosphere, they break into small pieces. And it's like rain. It falls on us like rain, like Professor Louis Frank from Iowa University proven in 1986. Every day, 30,000 meteors are falling on our world, which means an average every 3 seconds. And together, the weight of them is 600,000 tons per day. 600,000 tons per day. Imagine if it would fall in one shot without atmosphere. It would fall on our head. After one day in the creation, there would not be a world. As we see from picture we were taking from the spaceship Fowler in 1996, we see every 3 seconds a meteor is eating the world. So the bullets are hitting the person that's running, but he has a great protection. It hits, but nothing happens to him, and this is the life we live in. Then we have a very special place in the world. It's called Bermuda Triangle. Many, many ships disappear there, boats, planes, helicopters. They don't understand what's going on there. When boats are getting there, it's very dangerous. The Gemara, in Masechet Brachot, page 8, the Gemara says, there's 903 different kinds of way to die, lo aleinu. The worst one of all of them is askara, the way that the throat of a person slowly, slowly getting blocked until the person cannot breathe. Lo aleinu, it's a very, very bad way to pass away. From this entire topic, which seems that it doesn't have anything to do with the Bermuda Triangle, Rashi writes something very interesting. Rashi says, the Gemara says, there's a place in the ocean that cannot accept metal. So you connect the boards of the boat by using ropes and tar, but you're not allowed to use nails. If you use nails from metal, it's very dangerous. How Rashi arrived from the Askara sickness to the ocean? What's the connection? The same way you have to build the boats with ropes and to be precise that not even one drop would enter. That's how one drop of air does not enter the pipe and a person cannot breathe. That's the connection. But the interesting part, how it makes it scientific, that today they found out there's magnetic fields there that actually interfere with the radars of the boats and on the airplanes, and actually boats were made from metal. That's how they disappear there. No one knows where they are. They completely disappeared. The interesting thing is that 2,000 years ago, Rashi was 900 years ago, but speaking about the Gemara, they already knew about this before the way that the scientists discovered there's magnetic fields over there. When people speaking about telescopes, then Galileo Galilei and Hubble, they are getting the credit for making the first telescope. Someone told me once that Hubble started it and 30 years later Galileo completed it. One way or the other, we're speaking about 1608, Leminianam, 400 years ago, that's it. Before that, no one had telescopes supposedly. And therefore, the whole people in the world thought that there's maximum between 6,000 to 8,000 stars. When Galileo developed his telescope, which was 6 feet wide, and raised it to the sky, they discovered that there are much more galaxies and stars than what we thought. We just couldn't see them. Apparently, the information is incorrect. Why? In college, nobody heard about Rabban Gamliel. They heard about Albert Einstein, but they never heard about the Ramban that say whatever Einstein said, Ramban say 700 years before him about material, time exists only where material is. The Ramban speaks about it. But nobody heard about Nachmani in college. Nobody heard about Rabban Gamliel in college. Nobody knows in college this Gemara. The Gemara in Masechet Eruvin, page 43, Amud Bet, the Gemara says, Shfoferet etub, hayta lo l'Rabban Gamliel, shaya mabit. Rabban Gamliel had a tube that he used to look in it, ve'tzofe ba'alpaim ama bayabasha, ukenegda alpaim bayam. Alpaim ama, it's about one kilometer. 1 kilometer in the land and one inside the ocean, which makes it about 1.5 miles. 1.5 miles, about 30 to 40 blocks in Manhattan. Now imagine a person take a paper towel and he take this piece inside and he goes like this and he say, what are you doing, Moshe? He say, I'm trying to see people. I'm in 90th Street. I'm trying to see people on the Queensboro Bridge. So how can you see? Obviously, it was some kind of a magnified glass inside. The Gemara say he used to look in it and see people from 2,000 Amma, which is 1.5 miles away. The only way to explain it was that it was a telescope. Maybe it wasn't sophisticated like Rabban Gamliel, 6 feet wide, but it was a little tube. It was able to see people from far away. This was written approximately 2,000 years ago. Now, we're going into a new thing, which is very interesting. The Ramchal, Rabbi Moshe Chaim Lutzato, 200 years ago, in his legendary book, Mesilat Yesharim, Path to the Just, he wrote something that we all knew already before, but it's good to repeat. What does it say? When a person goes away from his creator, which makes mekaveros, makes sins, not only he spoiled himself, he actually affects the entire world. He spoils the world. However, if he controls himself and he sticks to his creator, not only he improves himself, he actually improves the entire world. The Japanese doctor Masaru Emoto had proven scientifically with a microscope that water that are in a place that people spoke spiritual positive things looks different than water that were in a place when people spoke bad things such as curses and other things. How exactly he did it? When you take the water and freeze them in a minus 270 something degrees, it's very, very low temperature. And then you come with the telescope, with the microscope, I'm sorry, then you look into those drops of water who now became ice, and the microscope shows you amazing symmetric things, looks like diamonds. Just when you get a diamond from the manufacturer, it has a beautiful shape, all kinds of shapes. This is how it looks. And sometimes it doesn't look nice and symmetric. The question is why? Why one drop of water would look perfect, beautiful plan, and the other one look completely messed up? The answer is, as we can see in front of us on the screen, this is some of the shapes that the microscope showed. On the right side, you have two beautiful drops of water. This is how they look in the microscope. And on the left side, this is, by the way, the Japanese doctor that we're talking about in front of you. On top of his head, you see a drop of water from a place that people used to curse and say bad things. It affected the shape of the actual water that were in that area, which is amazing. Based on this scientific discovery, an Israeli student named Tomer Raviav in Bar Ilan University, a chemist, had proven something even more interesting. What did he do? He took cotton, and he puts cotton in a lab, put some water in it, and put seeds on the cotton in one room, and he did it exactly the same thing in a second room. In one room, he put a group of people, Talmidei Yeshiva, to sit and read Tehillim all day next to those seeds. And in the other room, he put other people who all day, they sat and spoke Lashon Hara and cursed. That's all what they did. After 3 weeks, this is a scientific discovery, we're not talking a theory here. After 3 weeks, in a room where the people read Tehillim and learned Torah, everything grew beautiful, straight, tall, and bloom beautifully. And in a room that they cursed and spoke Lashon Hara all 3 weeks, nothing grew. Everything fell to the side, not symmetric, not tall, not straight, nothing whatsoever. When you speak about it as a hypothetically speaking, people can say, it's a wishful thinking. When it's proven scientifically, there's not that much to answer. So we find the words of the Ramchal today has better meaning in our eyes, because now we can see it in our own eyes that averos, sins that a person make, not only influence his neshama, influence the world around him. That's, by the way, explain why, according to Kabbalah, it's better not to buy objects and furniture from an idol worshippers who used to worship his idols on it. Even though the furniture wasn't the idol or wasn't used for the idol, it's enough that it was in the same room, it's already bringing bad mazal to the house of a person. So this is an example why this tradition from based on Kabbalah, where it comes from. This is some of the other shapes. Look how it looks. Even a professional diamond maker wouldn't be able to make such beautiful shapes, like flowers and all symmetric. This is drops of water in a negative 270 degrees in a lab based on a microscopic pictures. Next thing is, did you ever know that plants and trees have feelings? Did you ever think that a plant in your house sometimes is sad, sometimes is happy, sometimes is scared, sometimes is panicking? Did you ever think that it's possible? Well, if you learned the Gemara pretty well, then you knew the Gemara already discussed this. The Gemara, before the Gemara, in Pirkei de Rabbi Eliezer, chapter 30, Chazal saying, "Beshaa shekortim et ha'etz," when you chop a tree, his voice, his scream, goes from one side of the world to the other side of the world. The Gemara in Masechet Kritut, page 6, the Gemara says,
כשהוא שוחק, he's talking about preparing the ktores, when you grind the ktoret, שוחק, אומר הדק היטב, היטב הדק, talk to it, don't just do it, just talk to the spice, say, היטב הדק, הדק היטב, שהכל יפה לבשמים, why? When you prepare perfumes, things that have good smell, voice around it, improve the smell of the perfume, when there is voice around it. But when you make wine, for instance, it has to be a very quiet place. Why? If there is noise, it ruins the quality of the wine. Very interesting. The Gemara says, Rabbi Yochanan, Hillel HaZaken had 80 students. The greatest one, Yonatan ben Uziel, the smallest one in his level, we wish to have one like this in the world today, it was Rabban Yochanan ben Zakkai. He lives 120 years, was a perfect human being, the president of Israel, and he knew the languages of the angels, the demons, the trees, the language of the trees. The trees apparently has a language, Sichat Kalim. One time I spoke in one of my lectures, and by the end of the lecture, a scientist came to me, and he said, I'm very impressed. I said, why? He said, he saw this lecture, and he said, that part that you spoke about trees that communicate between them, I can tell you it's already proven scientifically. I said, how do you know? He said, I'll explain to you. So if you go to the forest, you find thousands of trees growing, and they're constantly expanding and become wider and wider. But you will never find that the branches touch each other. It's like they communicate. Where do you want to go? You want to go to the left? I'll go to the right. You go to the right? I'll go to the left. Im taimin asmila. Im asmila imina. The trees communicate. They do not collide. Even though they go into one or each other's territory, they do not make accidents. It's very interesting. This is a secular scientist told me. However, if you plant a tree next to the siding of your house, and the siding is made from wood, the tree would penetrate and crack the wood, the siding of the house. Why? Because this is a dead wood. It cannot talk. The life is expanding, but he doesn't get any warning. So he's expanding and expanding. And what happened in the end? He cracks the house. That's why they always tell you, make the tree a little bit far from the house, not too close. But this is based on the Gemara. How do we know that it's scientifically proven? So let's go to the next slide. In recent years, it was published by the greatest scientist that the world of the green, of the trees and the plants, that we thought that is just no feelings and no nothing, is not like that at all. Actually has strong feelings. And pain, and happiness, and fear. This was published in a scientific magazine, the British one, called Nature. The research of Chandra Bosa, a Gentile scientist, that checked the reaction of plants, and he connected wires, electric wire, into a carrot. And when you chop the carrot, or when you squeeze the carrot has pain and screams. And the scream of the carrot, which is actually in a different frequency, that's why we cannot hear it, creates energy that lights the flashlight. And they saw on the wall, electric. Now let me explain. The Gemara already told us that when you chop a tree, the tree is screaming from pain. Why the creator of the world doesn't let us hear the scream of the tree? Imagine life, the person wants to build himself a home, and he comes to the forest to chop some trees, like he used to be, in a primitive way. And as soon as he takes his axe and hit the tree, the tree begins to scream. Everyone would be homeless. No one would have a house. Why? People say, I'd rather be homeless for the rest of my life than making the tree suffer so much. Look how he screamed. My heart doesn't let me do it. So what did Hashem do? He fooled us in a way. He made our ear unable to hear the scream and the language of the trees. Same thing as animals. Very interesting. Animals, their ears work in a different frequency. They can hear what we cannot hear. I remember about 15 years ago, I bought a device that makes mosquitoes goes away from the house. You connect it to the outlet and no more mosquitoes. I was very skeptic about it, but after a week I saw really not one mosquito came. Then I saw that they have a red button on it. When you press on the red button, you hear such a whistle that you feel that it's about to rip your ears. What is this? It's demo. That shows you what the mosquitoes hear when they come near your house. That's why they run away, no wonder. The question is, why the mosquitoes hear it right now and you hear nothing? Why? Your ear is programmed to work in a certain frequency. Same thing, the lens of the eyes. What the eyes cannot see in space, the lens of the camera and the video camera detect. Many times people took pictures, and in the middle of taking picture, they see in a space faces of spirits, people who already passed away. The camera see it, but when the person took the picture, he did not see it in the room. Actually, about a month ago, I was in Florida, and one of the lectures that I gave there, it was in a house. And after the lecture, at least 20 people witnessed what I just told you. If you want more details, come to me and I'll give you more details. By the end of the lecture, the owner of the house, who is a frequent listener to my lectures, he say, you know, one of the things you discuss in your lecture, I want to show you something. Come to me. He took me to the room. He turned his computer on. And he said to me, you see, this is a picture, me and my son in a car. We sit in our minivan. Okay. Now, you ready for the next picture? He turned to the next picture. I see him and his son and an old lady, maybe about 80 years old, something like that. Clear face. Every wrinkle of the face you see, 100%. Very, very interesting. With color, the color of the skin, everything. So I said to him, what's this? He said, now when I took another picture of me and my son, when I took another picture, this came out. So I said, wow, who is this woman? Do you know her? She said, my grandmother's sister, a relative of the family that passed away a few years ago. So they took a picture, him and his son, and 20 people almost fainted when they saw this picture. The lens of the camera saw what he didn't see, which means this old lady was standing right next to him and his son, and they didn't even know, inside the car. And the camera saw it, what the eyes of a person does not see. Now we understand the words of the Zohar, the Kabbalah, that say if a person had permission to see what's around him in space for 1 second, he would not be able to stay normal. I would say everyone would run to the yeshiva, nobody would care about work, business, nothing. What are you doing? Where are the yeshiva? Where are the yeshiva? Let me run. Forget about driving. Running. Why? Out of fear. But that's not what Hashem wanted. Hashem wanted people to recognize what to do based on their logic and common sense. And Yiras Shamayim, not based on forcing you with scary things. That's not the intention there. So we see the ears. Sometimes you see animals, they look up in a quiet room, and the dog or the cat is jumping, running to the corner, beginning to cry. You look around, you don't understand what's happening. What's happening? He sees what you cannot see. And in my lecture, which I actually brought you a DVD, Life After Death, the last part of the lecture, the last 10 minutes, I show pictures that people took all over the world, and it was checked by a lab that it's not Photoshop. Some of them were taken before Photoshop software was invented, and people that took pictures, and the picture took images of people who died, and you can see their spirit inside the picture, like pictures in Auschwitz, and pictures in homes, and pictures in cemeteries. Very, very scary. Okay, so let's move on. One lawyer decided to make an experiment. What did he do? He spilled boiling water on a plant that he had in his office. While he was doing it, the plant was shrinking and screaming from pain. The measurement showed that this plant is suffering very much. But after that, every time that lawyer entered the room, the plant was already shrinking and going into defensive mode. So what do we see? That exactly what the Gemara spoke and look like metaphoric words, it's more than actual. It's 100% reality. Just we are not aware of it. The plants have feelings, the plants communicate, the plants talking, just we don't hear it, but it's already today a scientific fact. The Gemara, the words of Chazal, this is very interesting. It's in Midrash Rabbah Bamidbar Gimel. This is what it says. Ma'aseh betamara achat, a palm tree, שהייתה עומדת בחמתן. It was in one place called חמתן. ולא הייתה עושה פירות. No dates are growing on that palm tree. והיו מרכיבים אותה. They were trying to mix it with other palm tree, you know, the seeds, to get some fruit. And nothing helps. ולא הייתה עושה פירות. אמר להם רבי תנחומה said to them, דקלי תמרה היא רואה מיריחו, והיא מתאווה לה בליבה. This tree is in love with another tree. Where is this tree? In Jericho. אביו ממנה והרכיבו אותה. Go down, the view down to Jericho. Go get the seeds from that tree in Jericho. Mix the seeds of this tree that does not give any fruit with that tree over there in Jericho, and it will give you fruit. And miyad asta perot. As soon as they did like the rabbi told them, the midrash say, right away, it started to give fruit. So what do we see? That not only their feelings, it's almost mamash like people. Unbelievable. Let's move on. Time is running out. In the book of Yeshaya, chapter 40, Isaiah 40, this is what it says. Ayoshev al chug haaretz. If you ask the scientific world, when did we find out completely? There were many arguments. If the earth is flat, or the earth is round, or the earth is wavy, what's really the shape of the world? Nobody knew for sure. There's no NASA, no way to take pictures like today. So everyone had a different opinion. But the truth is, when you ask them when exactly the argument ended, the answer is 500 years ago, in the time of Columbus. Everybody understood at that generation that the world is really round. But the truth is, 2,600 years ago, already in the Tanakh, it says clearly that the world is round. The prophet Yeshaya writes, Ayoshev al chug haaretz veyoshveya kachagavib. Hashem is on top of chug haaretz. Chug in Hebrew means something moves in a circle, round. Rashi, 900 years ago in France, he was 400 years before Columbus. So even Rashi as a commentator, as a mefaresh, Rashi already wrote clearly, Al ha-shamayim, amar al ha-shamayim, ki hem chug ha-aretz, kmo she-yaseh adam b'mechoga, like in geometry, you make a circle with the mechoga. Why? The mechoga has two legs. One is stick and one is drawing. This is how the world is. How did Rashi know that? From the prophet, from the Navi. How the Navi knew 2,600 years ago that the world is round? Hashem told him. He wasn't the scientist, the prophet Yeshaya. His only information that was able to have based on what the creator of the world told us when he gave us the Torah. Just before we finish, and maybe have some time for questions, maybe 2 or 3 minutes, we know that the world is turning around in 1,700 kilometers per hour, which is about 1,100 miles per hour. Very fast. So why are we not getting dizzy? Why? The answer is because it's very, very big, but the space is endless. So nothing makes us dizzy because we don't really feel that we're turning around like that. If... Because the earth is turning around 1,700 kilometers per hour, that's what determined that the length of the day will be 24 hours. 12 hours day, 12 hours night. If the speed would be slower, like 170 kilometers per hour instead of 1,700, 10 times slower, the time of the day and night would be 240 hours. 120 hours day, 120 hours a night. And if that would be the case, all the trees and all the plants would die. You know what it is? 120 hours strong sun on the flowers. It would burn everything. It would completely dry everything, the land, everything. So everything would die. All the photosynthesa, which what creates the food on the plants, will all get ruined because of the sun. You cannot have too long suns on a tree. You need it on and off. So exactly what we need for our existence, this is how Hashem planned the speed of the earth. But it gets even better. Today, I one time met a person that bought a watch for more than $100,000. Philippe, Fatek, Philippe, whatever. So then he was bragging about the watch. He told me, you know this watch? I said, I never heard of it. I heard Rolex, I heard other watches, but this one never heard. He said, you know why you never heard of it? Because they never ever advertised. They refused to advertise. I said, what's the point? He said, we have the best product in history when it comes to watches. It's mandatory for you to search who we are. We're not going to come and be cheap and present ourselves to you. Like we are a VIP. Apparently it works for them. People buying these watches. But why am I telling you about this watch? This entire watch would not worth a penny if the earth sometimes would go a little bit faster and sometimes a little bit slower. It has to be 1,700 kilometers per hour. If it would go 1,690. Every once in a while, it gets tired. It's a problem with the energy. What his watch, he looks at his watch, it's worthless, it doesn't tell the right time. It has to be exactly the same speed for thousands of years. Never 1 meter more or less, it cannot be. Why? Judaism will be over. Why? No one would know when it's Kriyat Shema, Sof Hazman Kriyat Shema, when you can circumcise the baby, it's before Shkia, after Shkia. Why? Because in Judaism, time is critical. If we will not be able to rely on earth and the time and the system, then one day is like this, one day it's slow, one day it's fast, one day the day is shorter, one day it's longer, the entire Torah would be worthless. It would not be able to be a loyal Jew. So Hashem has to be precise with his creation. Some things in creation, one day is like this, one day is like that. No, it's no big deal. It doesn't affect the Torah and mitzvot. But when it comes to time, what is the meaning of the word Bereshit? The Ramban say, Bereshit, what is it? The creation of time. That means the time starts ticking. Bereshit, that's it. Once the material was created, there's no material without time. Material is working in a formula always with time in it. You cannot take time out of material. Everything we do in this world connects to time. But when we go to the upper worlds, when the soul comes out of the body and there's no more material, time has a different meaning, different aspect. That's why in a dream, when a person dreams, which is something that his soul is feeling, you can have in 9 seconds, the longest dream, the scientists claim it's 9 seconds. In 9 seconds, you can dream 6 months of events. I fell in the ocean, 3 days the sharks are around me, and then a boat came, and I thought finally I got saved, I'm starving, and then it was Muhammad and Mustafa from the Hamas, and they took me to Gaza, and they buried me 6 months under the ground, they're beating me up. So his wife tell him, hey, Itzik, you're only sleeping 1 minute. Exactly, we had this conversation with Mustafa, you know, in 1 minute. Why? He answer you answer him until you arrive to Gaza. This is months. Why? With the soul, it's different time, not like here. You can see right away. And that's, by the way, what they say, heaven and hell and all these things, it's all in a neshama. And the time is different. It's like a simulator. Whatever Hashem wants the person to feel, that's what he feels. He wants him to feel eternity, he feels eternity. He wants him to feel 1 year, he feels 1 year. It's a simulation, like in a dream. But it's very real, for good and for bad, chas v'shalom. So, mamash, last thing for today. The last thing is this. You know, when we read the story of the creation, we are very puzzled. We read the story of the creation and we search in the entire world and we don't find what the Sefer Bereshit is describing. Where is these rivers? Two heads from here, two heads from there. Some of it we see around, the Prat, the Achidekel, but it's not exactly as it's described in the Torah. And it said that Hashem created Adam in heaven, in Gan Eden, Garden of Eden, to be precise. Where is this Garden of Eden? Where? Australia, New Zealand, Israel, where is it? We look around, where is this place that Hashem said to Adam, watch my world, take care of the trees? We don't see it. There are many, many explanations according to Kabbalah, according to the Pshat, what exactly is the creation of the world, where Adam was exactly created, and what does it mean? One very simple way to understand it, which basically almost leaves no doubt, is very simple. The world was created in one way, and then after the Mabul, the flood, 4,200 years ago, everything changed completely. The Zohar, the Kabbalah says, that it was one continent, and after the flood, that spring water, hot water, came from spring, which is very deep under the ground, everything exploded from pressure, it broke into seven pieces, which what we see today, seven continents, and this is way before Columbus discovered America. So the Zohar is speaking about seven continents. Everything shifted, everything turned around. Whatever the Torah describes was one puzzle. After it broke to seven different ones, of course it's different. Now you may say, oh, beautiful theory. I don't believe in a Zohar. Prove it to me scientifically, then I'll believe. The answer is no problem. What is the answer? Alfred Wagner wasn't a Jew. He lived from 1880 to 1930. His discovery is one of the top 10 discoveries of the previous century. What did he discover? That the world was one continent, and at one point, he doesn't know so much about the Mabul, at one point it broke into seven pieces, and he took the seven continents and measured them and checked the colors and everything and put them together in a puzzle to show you where they broke from. That's the pieces that connected. And he won all kinds of awards for his discovery. This is what the Torah says, "Vayomer Elokim yikavu ha-mayim mitachat ha-shamayim el makom echad v'terayei yabasha." In the beginning, it was land and water. That's it. And after that, what happened? Hazohar say, "Eretz achat mamash." There was one land, really. "Otziu ha-mayim u'mimena nitavu sheva aratzot." And from that, it broke into seven different continents. Everyone in America thinks Benjamin Franklin was the president of United States. Almost everyone. Why? Because his picture is on a $100 bill. The old $100 bill, Zichrono Livracha. But why is so famous? He was a great politician, famous politician, but he wasn't the president. What was he? A scientist. What discovery he discovered that changed the face of the world and until today it affects each one of us? The answer is, today when the lightning hit an area, we know that if or will always go to the highest place in a city where metal is and focus in that area, which saves the people underneath. So that's a very way to protect us and to protect our animals. What can I do that Chazal, our sages already knew it. It was a piece of cake for them 2,000 years ago, way before Benjamin Franklin, way before United States, way before all the things that we learn in colleges. They already knew it. It was everyday life for them. But no one in college teach about Chazal, and no one make a $100 bill with all the sages on it. It would have to be the size, from here to Israel, the size of the $100 bill. So what is it? The Gemara said, the Tosefta, Anoten Barza, someone who puts metal, Ben HaEfrochim, between the chicks, the baby chickens, Areze Midarkei HaEmori. The Emori, they used to be masters of magic, black magic. They have all kinds of things to multiply the chicks, because it's good for business. The more chickens you have, the more money you make. So they used to make all kinds of kishufim. So the Gemara says, not allowed to use their kishufim, even if it's productive, This is not the way of the Torah. However, if you put it to protect them from the lightning, it's allowed. Nobody in college taught this to Sefta. We would have to burn the old $100 bill. They gave credit to the wrong one. However, he still deserves a credit. Why? Because he discovered it based on his own wisdom and intelligence and research, which is very impressive. But we as Jews who follow the Torah and the Talmud already know a lot of the things. I think time ran out. And maybe if you have some questions and, about what we spoke or about other things. But you can see, I can show you a quick display that there's many other slides in this lecture about the genes, about the creation of a person, about the baby becoming a human being in 48 days, how the Gemara knew before scientists, how twins are created, what they discovered in less than 20 years ago, how it was already in the Talmud that they knew that one seed goes into an egg and split into two. Information that no one was able to know unless we got it from the creator of the world. And many other things about rabies, the vaccine for rabies, how it was already in the Gemara, and Louis Pasteur was learning with the rabbi in France, and based on this Gemara, he gave him the idea to develop the vaccine for rabies to save the life of millions of people. And many other things that, you know, about the astronomy, about germs, about, as you can see, the Gemara, just briefly, the Gemara says, Amar Rabbi Yochanan, Kasa de Charshin velo Kasa de Poshrin. Better to drink water with black magic in it, with kishuf in it, than to drink lukewarm water that never boiled. Why? The Gemara say this is only if it's in a metal glass. If it's in ceramic glass, there's nothing to worry about. And also in metal glass, unless if it boiled, if it did not boil. But if it boiled, there's nothing to worry about, the Gemara say. So they knew what we do today. We pasteurize milk. We call it pasteurized milk based on Louis Pasteur's discovery that you have to boil the water to at least 80 degrees Celsius. Better to 100 degrees to boil them, that you see bubbles, that kills all the germs. The Gemara says if a person drinks from his friend's mouth, he's risking his life. This is information that no one knew until 100 years ago in the world. No one. But we knew basically everything. This lecture is beautiful, but there's no time, and I want to keep you here until the evening. So thank you very much for coming, and hope we meet again. Thank you very much. Thank you.